Hi, welcome on my YouTube channel. Today, in this episode, I will follow the command what I find in this Roland MC-909 groovebox under the program 709. Ta-da! So this is what I will do for you in this episode. This is the Roland MC-909 groovebox, and in the past this groovebox, it's a bit expensive. It's around $1,200 or $1,400 even. And this groovebox is really, we can say no, it's a part of the history. I have a couple of issues with some keys and buttons. For example, this tap is not really working well. It's time to time is get stuck. Now you can see it's not changing nothing. And also I have some buttons which is not always working perfectly. Now you can see this is, for example, is jumping too, but maybe where is I think here the octave, yeah, it's going up very nicely, but if I coming down, it's jumping almost two all the time. So yeah, you can see here, hop, it's jumping by itself. So minus one, minus two, minus three, now it's okay. So it's not consistent, all the buttons. So I have a really basic repairment on that. I just have to clean the buttons. So yeah, because of that, I have to open the whole device. I have to remove all the pots, all the caps, or everything from the front. And I also have to take off the whole electronic from inside. So this will be a really interesting teardown for you. Or if you're just thinking on by this Roland MC-909 groovebox, now you can have a look inside. So let me start the teardown. Yeah, keep it cool. Oh, tear it down. It's a beast of machine. It's, I think it's around 4 or 5 kilograms of metal. So this is definitely not a plastic MIDI controller with your laptop or whatever. This is really a machine. So what I found? Oh yeah, yeah. Lot of things. The MC-909, it can be extended with SRS soundboards, which is really popular in the Roland synthesizers. So basically nothing fancy you can find inside. It's this is the audio IO board, and I'm telling you guys from here, from close, the Roland again used a lot of high quality capacitors on outputs. Oh, Nichicon gold caps, yeah. I no have clue why they are not closed into some kind of metal case. And it's basically just a protector for human touch. And I don't think so the noise from this switching power supply, it cannot be go into somewhere else. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. So you see, this is really high quality audio capacitors from Nichicon, and nothing fancy on it. I expected a bit more audio circuits on that, and this is what I really not understand. This two port is the audio input, and closest to that you find this high frequency, high voltage generator for the LCD backlight. And I don't know how they solve it to not get noise from that into the audio input. This is the digital SPDF driver chip, and the output is not driven directly from the chip. It's really interesting. It's driven that cross this adjustable coils, and but the input, it's connected directly to that chip. So yeah, it's interesting. And on here, nothing fancy. It's just a serial port driver for the MIDI. Oh yeah, a lot of Roland custom chip you can find inside. The Roland always did in the past exactly specialized ICs for the sound. Yeah, it's really interesting. And in these huge chips, if you can get the technical documentation, you just say, wow, how much specialized low frequency DSP solutions it's inside in those chips. So on this CPU board, I cannot find nothing more really interesting stuffs. Maybe nothing. It looks to me like a specialized computer inside. So let me go forward. By the way, I don't know why the factories are using 100 different kind of screws for everything. Yeah, this is unbelievable. This is the fifth type of screws that I find in this Roland MC-909. Oh, we're almost in. Yeah. Other side. Wow, lot of passives. So tiny, lot of passives everywhere. It's made in China. And the name, the number is Sharp LM320191. So if you have some kind of issue with your LCD, this is what you have to look for it. And nothing fancy, it's just a really old type, old kind of LCD with its own sharpness issues and the contrast issues. Yeah, it's really a piece of so this switching power supply, it's really interesting. Why did I not place it into some metal case? And what I really don't like about it is the main line, it's coming directly under your fingers. And maybe why they cannot place it somewhere here, for example, like this. I no have clue. Rubicon, thank you very much. Rubicon everywhere. Rubicon everywhere. So yeah. This, come on, it's just a normal power supply, nothing interested. But with this construction, I think you can be sure, you easily can get a replacement on this power supply, or you can send it like this to some professional if you have some issue with that. And basically you easily can repair that power supply. This one and this one is for the spatial beam controller, where you can play with your palms on it. So it's sending a infrared light outside with kind of angle, and of course when you came to closer you get more reflection from your palms into the sensor. And they place this on two individual PCB. Maybe he glued that? wall. Oh, it's some kind of beer or cola. Yeah. Okay. Come out. Oh la la. I'm telling you guys, this is big. May you think this is nothing fancy going on that PCB, but let me tell you, it's not fully true. What I find always in Roland synths and groove boxes like MC-303 or 505 or 808, it's the Roland always pay a big attention on a timing. So why it's so important that the timing on this professional level of instruments? Because everything which is going and happening in the DSP and in the CPU, it's really hardly attached to the timing of the music. So basically, the Roland always apply some kind of really high computing power on a scanning on the human interface. You can see the Roland applied not one but two processor which is handling all the key presses and all the movements on all potmeters. Here you can see how it's important for them the quickest scanning on the human interface. So basically the main CPU is sitting here, which is controlling all the memory buses and all the DSP and the ROM and everything and all the IOs and blah blah blah. But the panel board itself, it has one CPU which is running on 20 megahertz, and the secondary key scan controller, it's only dedicated for this 16 keypad with velocity sensitivity. It's get the timestamp, then you play on your instrument, and until the next timestamp will arrive, this CPU, it's pack everything together like a one data pack, and bang, it send it to the main CPU. So this is why this panel in the Roland MC-909 is really interesting. It's, I'm telling you, it's not a cheapest normal matrix driving solution. Basically, this is the 16 velocity pad where you can play a music on it. But why we have one section, two section and three section? Basically, this, the top one and the bottom one, it's connected together, so this is running parallelly. But the middle one is totally living in his own way. So actually, the top one and the bottom one is working like one switch, and this middle area is working like another switch. So how this Roland key scan CPU get the information about what is the speed how you pressed down? This is the outside, and this is the inside area of the switch. So when you press down, you may think, oh, this two switch is switched together, because the silicon pad top of it, it's like a one surface. There is a trick. Maybe you can see from here. Yeah, from here you can see. You see, there is around 2 millimeter or 3 millimeter difference between the outside and the inside. From here, maybe you can see. You see? So this is what's happened when you press down this silicon pad. So first, the outside will touch the PCB, and then your inside will touch the PCB. So what's happened in this switch? This is the outside, and this is the inside. So when you press down, this 2-3 millimeter of difference between the height is give a bit of time difference between the two low signal level. So this key scan CPU, it start the counter inside until the next switch is came to be the low status, and then this key scan CPU, it's count just the numbers, and the length of this time, it's in some kind of equation between the velocity, because if you press quick, this time gets shorter. If you press slowly, this time will be get longer. This is how Roland did this keypad on the MC-909. I think it's pretty interesting, and let me tell you, I find the other tricky, because if you came from the analog world, you never see something like this. But in the digital world, how you handle the pot meters, it's a total different story. What a hell on earth doing this small capacitor and this big capacitor together with this long fader? So in analog world, if you connect a capacitor to your output of your pot meter, of course you will get some kind of filtering, or the frequencies get some kind of weird modulation or whatever. But in the digital world, this is a really important stuff here. This is our pot meter, which is 100 something millimeter long, and after the tap point, you have this resistor. And this is this small capacitor, and this is what I ask, what the hell is doing this capacitor here, and why is attached to the output of your pot meter? Here on that side, nothing fancy is going, it's just a big buffer capacitor to hold the 5 volt, which is came from the 5 volt rail, make sure the all the losses from the cable and whatever, it will charge up this capacitor, and when you move your fader, this 5 volt will not move too much. This other one, it's again a normal filter capacitor, nothing fancy, but this one is do a kind of trick in a digitized human interface. So let me explain to you what is this for. All the faders, even if you buy a new one or really high precision fader or whatever, because the top surface is open, after a short time, it's never give you a really clean signal when you move your fader. Now I just did this like really drastic, make you sure you will understand. So this is how it looks like if you look on under the magnifier, the signal what is coming out from your pot meter when you are moving, because even a pot meter is new, there is a small differences on the surface of the pot meter, and this spike here, it represent a dust on your pot meter. So, and now maybe you ask, oh, okay, but this is digitized, and who cares if there is noise on the pot meter? There is a trap for young players. Let me explain to you. So, let's say this fader pot meter, it's connected into this 20 megahertz local CPU, and this local CPU, it has an analog input where this CPU is running assembling, and here is your spike. And let's say this CPU is running on 10 kHz or 20 kHz on the sampling, and it's only 8-bit or 10-bit. It's far away more than enough to get data on your fader movement. So let's say your CPU is do a sampling, and this sample it's here, and this sample it's here, and this sample is here. So what's the problem with that? If you have spikes from dust or high voltage from your body, this sample can cause a lot of problem in your DSP calculation, because these levels it's converted into numbers, and there is a lot of equation in the DSP system which is depend on these values. It doesn't matter now it's the tempo potmeter or other the filter potmeter or whatever. You always find a capacitor on an output of the potmeter. So what the capacitor is do with that spike, of course, will create a bit softened output from your fader. So in this case, if you have this capacitor, you can be sure your sampling will not get weird rapid changes in the values, because let's say this value is 100, this value is 120, this 100 is 130, but this one, let's say 200, and then you go back to 100 to 140, and your DSP, exactly, for example, this fader, it's dedicated for do a tempo changing. Here is the three different playback speed solution. This one is the original signal. Let's say this is 100% of the playing speed. Other one, it's let's say it's 50% of the original speed, and the last one is also 50% of the original speed, but this one it has to be keep the pitch on the same level. For example, this wave here, let's say, is 1 kHz, and if you want to stretch the time by 50% to 50%, then of course your 1 kHz signal will become to 500 Hz signal. But if you want to keep the pitch the same, the DSP has to fill this gap with a total same frequencies. And there is a lot of different solution how the DSPs can do that. One solution, for example, it's take a piece of sample from here and from everywhere, and if you stretch the time, the DSP try to find from different samples which sample will fit to here, and the next sample will be fit to here and whatever, and also playing with the levels, and there is also some kind of really complicated mathematic formula when the two signal can connect together without, let's say, without this gap. So this is really annoying, and this is a kind of sound what you can find in cheap DJ solutions, and but the professional ones, they always do a really high quality mathematic formulas on the time stretching. So back to here, and this one is the other kind. It's just basically on the MC-909 you can choose between the two type of tempo changing, to keep the original pitch or not keep the original pitch. So what can happen if your potmeter give a wrong signal? Of course, the DSP like a small time machine, has to be look backward, and based on your fader movement, he has to modify all these calculations to fill up this gap. And let's say you have this spike, so it's measuring, let's say, 50% of original speed, and then immediately jump to 90%. Then, of course, the DSP again do a short calculation in a really short time, because the spike is just like this. So on the next sample, you again back to the 50. So the DSP cannot follow this amount of rapid changes in input datas. So because of that, you have to apply some kind of filtering solution after your potmeter. On the other side, of course, all the DSP equations, which is dealing with speed or pitch, it has a lot of other mathematical formulas how to do this smooth signal inserting, or other solution, it can be like a delayed signal. It's like this is your original samples, and from that you create a second one which is a bit delayed, and if you stretch your time from here to here, you just played again this piece of delayed signal, and of course the DSP has to take care of the null points, so it has to be find one full phase and then insert this one full phase, and then if there is a small time which is missing, he also has to calculate some kind of fake signals to here to make sure it can connect to the next signal. So yeah, I think I spoke a bit too much about this small capacitor, but believe me, if you're dealing with digitized human interface, which is analog, you have to apply some kind of filtering solution. By the way, this 10 nano capacitor is also do a high frequency filtering from the pot, because of course you touch with your finger, so it easily can get a hum or radio signals into the middle tap of your pot meter. So, and this is the basically this is the input from this pot meter. You can see here in the input amplifier, which is making the high impedance input from your pot meter, it doesn't have any kind of filtering. It's just one-to-one normal buffer open solution. So this is why they care of the high frequency contents and filter out the spikes here locally close to the pot meter. The last interesting thing what I find, the tap tempo, it has its own dedicated channel which is running into the main CPU of the user interface. So Roland always pay a big attention on a timing. So that's all from the user interface on electronic way. So now what I have to do, it's a really simple job. I just have to clean this board, and I have to apply some kind of graze into the pot meters, and how I always do with this kind of switches, I always press down, then I apply there this alcohol, make sure I have enough, and then I really slowly release up, and maybe you can see, I hope you can see, but it's sucked in the alcohol. So again, press down, and if I did a good job, now it's like a sprinkler. It came on a corners. It's like when you press down, it's piece is coming out, so let me apply more from that alcohol. Okay, now it's under, absolutely. And then I just have to get off the remains, and so now you can see it's outside is totally dry, but if I press it down, it will again will come out. You can see in this corner, it's coming out, so I hope this is really cleaned out from inside. And also, it's make a good job if you move from side to side or out from the center. And yeah, that's all. I don't know what is this, but it looks to me, maybe there you can see, this is some kind of remains from some animal. So let me clean this out also, because it can be a small issue on your user interface matrix can cause a lot of problem in other parts. So I think because it's exactly sitting on some kind of double diode, I think it can fuck up some other timing in the matrix. So let's clean it. Yeah, it's some kind of bug with brothers and sisters and father, mother, all the family is living inside. Yeah, so now this part is clean, and let me clean the whole surface. Maybe the previous owner, he dropped a couple of beer inside or cola or something. So now I have to clean all the buttons one by one. It's actually really cheap. It's like 80 cent or 90 cent or something like this in Edeka. I'm telling you guys, this green frog can clean every surface, every chemicals, every dust, every fat, oil, whatever. So yeah, I really like it. And so now the buttons are just swimming in this bucket in hot water, and a lot from that. So I hope in 10 minutes or 20 minutes this cola and beer will be start to came off. That's the cola. Yeah, let's add a bit more from the green frog. Whoa! But you can see already the water is start to come dirty, even if I'm not washed each one. Yeah, and also I have to dry immediately with air compressor. So yeah, it will be half an hour of cleaning fun. I also find other kind of analog type of issue in my Roland MC-909, and maybe this problem is really common because everybody can do some kind of defect on a output. In the headphone output, I didn't get this kind of pops and quirks. So let me draw it to you what I find on output point B, which is actually the connector of your jack output. So the signal, the positive side, it looks really nice until the negative, it's arrived somewhere minus 3.2 volt or something like this, and then some really weird artifact is came to the signal, and later on all this signal, all this AC signal is start to lift up by 0.6 volt or something like this. So when I saw that on my oscilloscope, first I think, oh, that cannot be my digital to analog converter, maybe it's dead. But then I measured here, which is actually before the coupling capacitor, but after the last op-amp, which is doing for you the last amplification from your converter. So in point A, before the capacitor, is everything is looks really nice, and the center of the signal, it's exactly sit on the 0 volt. So then I start to think maybe the capacitor is dead, or I don't know, and then I find this puppy here. So this transistor is making a mute from your Roland MC-909, and the mute is controlled by a Simply Logic IC, which is running on CMOS signal. So this is the other end of this muting circuit, and as you see, there is nothing really fancy going on. It's just hooked up to the positive 15 volt and to the negative 15 volt. And basically this small switching transistor, this is what controlled by this CMOS logic IC. And so when this get 3.3 volt from this logic IC, then of course all this transistor, it's jump to the other position, and because of that, on that output you will get a positive almost 15 volt. So then I did a measurement, and I switched on the Roland MC, and this positive 15 volt, it exists on that point and also here on the transistor. So under the muting, these two transistor is worked perfectly. But when the muting signal is disappeared, I measured here around minus 2 volt or something like this. And I start to think how it can be minus 2 volt on this switching transistor. It's maybe wrong, because it has to be close to the minus 15 volt, because if this transistor is not operating, then this all this line, it has to be get this minus 15 volt from across this resistor. So but how these two transistor can do a function of muting, because the muting is really simple. From here across this capacitor, your signal is going across this 680 ohm resistor, and then came to this 100 ohm resistor, and there is some kind of really high frequency filtering going on. This is your last, let's say, fuse, or again, this is just a normal coil, and then is go directly to your jack output. So when the muting is coming, then the signal cannot go to this direction because this transistor, when it's closed, then this transistor, it has a really low value of resistance. Actually, this spatial transistor, this 2SC3326A transistor, is exactly made for muting or for switching signals. So it's mean the emitter and the collector resistances can go down really low values, like a couple of ohm. So under the muting, this transistor worked perfectly, but when the muting voltage is disappeared, then this transistor, it's actually came like a Zener diode. And what's happened here, it's like around minus 3.2 volt, this Zener diode is switched on and made a distortion on my signal. Then I realized, okay, this transistor is dead, and this transistor is also dead. Maybe the previous owner, he plugged something, tube amplifier, or I don't know, some kind of club gear to here, so it can defect these two transistors, but on a really interesting way, just defected the transients between the emitter and the base. So this Panasonic DVD, it saved my life with this Roland MC-909. Don't forget, this is the same DVD where I find this switch, and here is the Roland switch. So yeah, this Panasonic DVD is used as total same technology, and I think this is the best solution to do a general muting when you start up your digital stuff and you don't want to hear some really weird signal came out from the line out. So I salvaged out. Here is this two transistor. This is one, and the other is sitting here. And now everything is looks to me work perfectly. And now, just for experiment, I did here something, let's say, unusual, but I read some article on the internet about coupling capacitors and polar, bipolar, not polar, whatever. Really interesting. This last op-amp is working on a positive 50 to negative 15 volts, so it's meaning the output, when it's not get signal, is 0 volt. And when the signal coming here, this also going to the positive and to the negative. So I don't think so. It's good idea to use this kind of coupling after this kind of op-amp amplifier solution. The normal polarized electrode capacitors, they not give you a same capacity on a positive and on a negative direction. And don't forget, this Roland MC-909 can generate minus 4, minus 5 volt even. If you do a setting in a system setting, you can drive the output with plus 12 dB. So it's meaning it's easily can go up to minus 6 volt on a negative phase. So now I just want to hear the difference. So yeah, on the end, I placed everything together. So in this video, I repaired these small issues with the switches and with the pots. And also I repaired this tap tempo switching the corner, and on the end I also find this problem with the output, and I hope you enjoyed. Yeah, let's make some noise with it. I just want to shock you with some German club music. Listen to this. It's awful.